God, giving us a chance to praise you, Lord. We will not be defeated. We are more than overcomers. The enemy is under my feet. Every lie he speaks is defeated. The enemy is under my feet. Every lie he speaks is defeated.
The enemy is under my feet.
Oh,
everyone in this place. So let's give him a little bit of that right now.
your voice up to him. Lord, you're worthy of praise, God.
Redeemer, mighty in battle, Jesus our Savior.
Behold you in all of your glory. War is over. We're victorious. We're the winners.
Say,
oh, we wait.
Just to see you, Lord.
To behold you in all of your glory.
War is over.
We're victorious. just for a few more moments. Can we get beside ourselves? Can you grab somebody's hand beside you and worship like their victory is just there, that they have just got to receive the victory that God is wanting to give you tonight? Can you pray for somebody and help them pray and let the victory is here tonight for you and your family and your home tonight. All you got to do is reach out and grab what God is wanting to give to you.
Will break you to position you, break you to promote you, and break you to put you in your right place. But when he breaks you, he doesn't hurt you. He doesn't, when he breaks you, he doesn't destroy you. He does it with grace. Anybody been gracefully broken? Where? Ooh. Thank Thank you, Lord. Thank you. So, Father, tonight we're broken before you. Thank you for handling us with grace. Your worship right there in this moment. All I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Come on, sing. Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire. Set me on fire. Here I am. arms wide open. I'm right here pouring out my life gracefully.
just for a few moments with no music at all. Can we lift our voices to God? Can we just love God just for a few moments? A few more moments. Can we just love God? It doesn't take people to pump us up to get to where we would need to be. God, I ask right now, God, that you would just let your spirit freely reign into our souls, God. God, for every need that is in this place, God, I pray right now, God. God, that the hedges would be broken, God. The chains would be loosened, God. And God, that we would freely worship you. God, and we would love you like nothing else matters. God, I thank you for what we feel in this place. God, you didn't have to die for me, but you chose to. God, I love you, Jesus. God, I worship you, God, because you're worthy. Come on, just for a few more moments. How much do you really love God? If he was to walk by you right now, would you have shown him all the love that he deserves? Or would he just pass you by? God seeks for those that worship him, that love him unconditionally, with no strings attached. God, I thank you, Jesus. God, I worship you, Lord. God is surely in this place right now. And he wants to touch our needs. And with that being said, there's one need that we all need to lift up each day of this week. Bishop Wilson's granddaughter goes into surgery tomorrow. And I believe God is able to touch this little child. I believe God is able to touch and comfort this family. So if we could, one more time all across this auditorium, can we lift our hands and our voices and can we pray for this baby right now? God, I pray, God, that your hand would be upon Zuri, God. God, that you would touch her right now, God. God, that you would comfort the parents and the grandparents right now, God. God, I pray, God, that you would just build a hedge of protection around this child. And God, I thank you for it, God. God, and I give you glory and honor, God. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, I thank you, Jesus. As you are making your way back to your seats, and as the ushers are getting ready to take up tonight's offering, there's a couple of announcements. Choir, don't forget practice tomorrow at 6:30 and also Saturday at 2 p.m. One more. We need names of people, of families that need food. We are giving the turkeys that Pastor and Adrian has been mentioning for quite some time now. We need names to deliver this to. So if you've got names, please turn them in. Let's pray over the offering tonight. God, I thank you for what we feel. God, I pray for the remainder of this service, Lord. I pray, God, that you would just bless the remainder of this service, God. Bless the message tonight, God. And I just pray, Lord, that you would move over this offering, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Follow the leading of the ushers.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. That is who you are.
I'm so glad that I know him. Oh, that's right. Let's go ahead and praise him tonight. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise God. Lord, we love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we glorify your name. Isn't it wonderful to feel the presence of the Lord in this place? Isn't it wonderful to feel the power of God in this house tonight? Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's right, let's go ahead and praise him some more. Lord, we glorify your name because you're worthy, because your goodness and your mercy and your grace. Amen. Go with me, if you will, to the book of Genesis, chapter number 29. The the book of Genesis, chapter number 29. Remember, tomorrow night they do have music practice at 6:30, prayer at 7:30. We have church at 7:15 on Wednesday night. Our children's classes and youth classes will be going. I ask that you pray for that session. We have a leadership session also for our department directors on Wednesday night, so remember that as well. Amen. On Thursday evening, we'll be boxing up food for delivery on Thursday and Friday, and if you can help in any way, see Brother Adrian after service, and he can help give you some direction for that. Praise the Lord. I'm excited about being able to bless other people. Amen. As has been mentioned, we still have room for names. If you have people that you'd like this church to bless, then please give us their name. We would like to be a blessing, and we hope that you'll be involved in that. We still have several that we can give away, and we're going to do our best. So if you'll turn those names in, we certainly appreciate your help. And maybe it's not somebody that necessarily can't get their own meal, but maybe they've gone through a difficult situation, something in their life, and they just need encouragement. You're welcome to turn those names in, and we want to be a blessing to people. Praise the Lord. Next Sunday morning at 8:45, we have Difference Makers. At 10 o'clock, we have our morning service. There'll be no ministry class next Sunday afternoon, but on Sunday night, we will have our music program for Christmas, and Brother Michael Maupin is going to be here as well, so we're looking forward to a good time. On Christmas Eve, the 24th, we'll have a morning service only, and so that evening you'll spend with your family, and then the schedule, the remainder of the holiday season, will be our regular schedule. Amen. The book of Genesis, chapter number 29, and then we'll read one verse from Isaiah, chapter number 12, Genesis 29, 1 through 3, and then verses 7 through 10. What a wonderful move of the Holy Ghost that we've had tonight. Amen. Man, what a powerful. There was a time in that altar, I don't know if I've ever felt God as strong as I felt him. Right then, just an overwhelming, wonderful, gracious presence of the Lord that moved into this house. Amen. I'm so thankful to be in an apostolic church where we still preach and teach the apostles' doctrine, which is repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm so glad I've been born again the Bible way. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The book of Genesis, chapter number 29, if you found it, say praise the Lord. Then Jacob went on his journey and came into the land of the people of the east. And he looked, and behold, a well in the field. And lo, there were three flocks of sheep lying by it. For out of that well they watered the flocks. Notice this phrase, and a great stone was upon the well's mouth. And thither were all the flocks gathered. And they rolled the stone from the well's mouth and watered the sheep and put the stone again upon the well's mouth in his place. Verse number 7, now it's talking about Jacob. And he said, and Jacob said, lo, it is yet high day. Neither is it time that the cattle should be gathered together. He said, the cows aren't going to come and run the sheep off. The sheep are already here. So he said, water ye the sheep and go and feed them. And they said, we cannot until all the flocks be gathered together, until they roll the stone from the well's mouth, and then we water the sheep. And while he yet spake with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she kept them. And it came to pass, when Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, that Jacob went near and rolled the stone from the well's mouth and watered the flock of Laban his mother's brother, and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. He said, water the sheep. And they said, we cannot till they roll the stone away from the well's mouth. I don't know who they are, but I don't like them. I don't know who they were that determined when someone could get a drink and when they couldn't. But I don't want someone else determining when I can have my breakthrough. Isaiah 12 and 3, therefore with joy shall ye draw water out of the wells of salvation. Look at somebody and say, therefore with joy shall ye draw water out of the wells of salvation. There was a great stone upon the well's mouth. And they said, we can't until they move the stone. I want to preach for a little while tonight on the subject, how to open a well. How to open a well. I was preaching this morning, and as the service was coming to a close, and I'll be honest, I had another message that I was going to preach tonight. But as the service was drawing to the close, the Lord began to deal with me that there were people who wanted water but didn't know how to open a well. And so I'm going to preach tonight with the help of God how to open a well. Lord Jesus, I praise you and I thank you because there is indeed a well of living water in this place tonight. God, there's water from heaven that has been flowing in this place. And Lord Jesus, I thank you, God, because you have visited this house. And God, I ask you tonight, Lord, to have your way. I ask you specifically, Lord Jesus, to bless the preaching of your word. I ask for your anointing to come upon me and on my mind and my heart and my spirit to deliver the word as you give it to me, Lord. And God, I pray specifically for an anointing upon ears to hear what the Spirit would say to the church tonight. God, I pray that the anointing of the Holy Ghost would anoint every person in this church. Give us ears to hear, Lord. God, give us ears to hear and let the seed of your word find good ground in our life and let it bring forth fruit. God, I bind every power of darkness that would try to hinder the receiving and the hearing of your word. And I pray, God, let the word be mixed with faith in our hearts. And I pray, God, that the Holy Ghost would confirm the word with signs following. In the name of Jesus, I pray that you do a work in this place. God, I come against every spiritual resistance against your word and the ministry of your word. And I pray, God, for the great anointing of the Holy Ghost to flow. Destroy every yoke in this place. I bind every spiritual power of darkness, every demonic spirit from hell that would like to steal the word from somebody. God, and I pray, Lord, in the name of Jesus, let there be a free flow of the water from the wells of salvation in this place. And I pray, God, in the house of the Lord tonight, let there be liberty, let there be deliverance, let there be freedom, and most of all, let there be water to flow freely on somebody's dry and thirsty soul in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Give a Lord a praise tonight. That's right. Give a Lord a praise tonight and worship him. Oh, hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Lord, we praise you. That's right. Let's go ahead and praise him some more. Amen. The Holy Ghost wants to do a work in this place. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. You can be seated. Thank you for standing in the presence of the Lord. In ancient times, wells were of utmost importance. Even today, wells are valuable. Digging wells is an extremely valuable and necessary business. I remember back a few months ago when I was riding in a car across the Arabian desert. We drove for hours and hours through the desert going from Muscat to Dubai. We drove for miles seeing nothing but sand dunes. Nothing but wind-blown sand. Occasionally a barren rocky hill would protrude from the sand, but other than the occasional rocky outcrop, there was nothing, no plants, nothing but rock and sand. And then as we would come across that desert, off in the distance, I would see a dot of green. And as we got closer, I would realize that there was an oasis that we were approaching. Here in the dry, barren, hot desert, there was this small area of life. Here, a well had been found. And where there was a well, the desert bloomed with beautiful life. Palm trees and flowers. And then a few houses and buildings would surround the oasis. And then after a little bit of time, we would pass that well, and there would be nothing but sand and rock until the next oasis. In ancient days, men would dig wells as a means of survival. Abraham in your Bible was a well digger. Everywhere he would settle, he would dig wells. When he gained land, he would dig wells for his livestock and his family to drink water from. Abraham was a well digger. Eventually, Abraham grew old and died, and the Bible said that the Philistines developed a strategy to destroy Abraham's descendants. Their strategy was to take earth, dirt, mud, rocks, and they would fill the wells that Abraham dug with earth, and they would stop the flow of water. Soon the land would dry out. Before long, where there was green grass, it would wither away and die. The palm trees that dotted the land where Abraham had dug wells would soon begin to dry up and wither and die. Isaac, Abraham's son, had a decision to make. He could dig wells or he could die. Crying about what the Philistines did wouldn't cause water to come out of the earth. Worrying about it and wringing his hands wouldn't bring water to his flocks and to his family. Complaining about it wouldn't bring water from the earth. Isaac could move on or he could dig a well. Amen. Isaac had a choice to make. This was his land. It was his inheritance. It was his promise. And he decided that if his father was a well digger, then Isaac would be a well digger. Amen. You can give up or you can dig wells. Abraham was a well digger. Isaac was a well digger. And I've decided that I'm going to be a well digger as well. Amen. The enemy stopped up the wells, but Isaac dug the well again. May I tell you tonight that there is an enemy that wants to stop up the wells that our fathers have dug. An enemy that doesn't want water being drunk from the wells of salvation. An enemy that doesn't want your children drinking from the well and your grandchildren drinking from the well. He wants your marriage to dry up. He wants your walk with God to dry up. He wants your prayer life to dry up. He wants your worship to dry up. The enemy wants to stop up your well. The Philistines were the mortal enemy of God and his people. They hated people that worshiped God. The Philistines hated people that prayed to God. Amen. But the Bible said in Genesis 26 and 18, and Isaac digged again the wells of water which they had digged in the days of Abraham, his father. For the Philistines had stopped them after the death of Abraham. He called their names after the names which his father had called them. Amen. When Abraham died, the Philistines thought it was an opportunity to stop up the wells, and it was up to a next generation. It was up to the next generation to dig the wells again. So Isaac went back, and he didn't dig a new well. He dug an old well. He didn't find new water. He knew where the water had always come from. The same place where Abraham had got it. He knew there would be water in that well. Can somebody say praise the Lord? Abraham dug a well, and Isaac redug the well. And he gave it the same name that his father had called them. May I say to every one of our younger generations of this church that the enemy has watched us as one by one we have buried our elders, and one by one we put good people that dug this church out of this wilderness. We put them in the ground one after another. And may I tell you that the wells that Abraham dug, the Philistines are trying to stop them up. The devil doesn't want there to be a holiness church in Marshall County. The devil doesn't want there to be a holiness preaching, praying, worshiping church in this area. And it's going to be up to the next generation to decide, are we going to move on, or are we going to dig the wells again that our fathers dug? Oh, come on, somebody, and help me preach. I'm telling you, I don't want a new well. I want an old well. I want to be like Miriam in the desert and sing, spring up, old well. I still want an old well of holiness. I've come to tell you that we don't need a new well of modernism that turns away and throws away the standards that this church was built on. We need the same well. Amen. It's still holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. It's still one God, Jesus' name baptism, talking in tongues. Our women still don't cut their hair. Our women still look like women, and our men look like men. We don't decorate ourselves with the things of this world. We've come out from bondage. And I'm telling you, we still preach the same thing. You may not want it, but we're digging the same wells that we've always dug. I wish I had an old saint. You don't have to get up. I know your legs are tired. I know your back's tired, but I wish you'd just preach on me. Preach me on a little bit right now while I tell the young people, we're not turning back. We're not going back. We're digging old wells again. Amen. You know what I found out? Not everybody wants holiness preaching. Not everyone wants a holiness church. But I tell you, one person that does want a holiness church, Jesus Christ is coming back for a church without spot and without blemish. He said, it's holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. You don't have to want a standard, but God wants a standard. You don't have to want holiness, but God wants holiness. Dig again the well. Let's go back to the well and let's rediscover why we are, who we are, and why we do what we do, and why we live how we live. Let's go back to the same well and dig it again. Come on, son. I ought to have some middle-aged folks that's preaching with me right now too. He digged again the wells of water which Abraham had dug. The Philistines top them up. They put earth, they put dirt and rocks in the well. The Bible said that we are earthen vessels. God formed man out of the dust of the earth. Man was made out of dirt. I find it not a coincidence that when they tried to stop the wells, they stopped them with the earth. They stopped them with the dirt and the things of this world. And I will tell you that if this well is going to be stopped, it's going to be stopped when our dirt gets in the way, when our flesh gets in the way, when our humanity and our worldliness gets in the way of what God wants to do. I'm going to tell you, there's nothing in this world that's worth losing the well of salvation for.
The water that comes from heaven is worth everything, no matter what you got to do to get it, no matter what you got to do to have it. God, don't let me ever put anything in front of my well. God, don't let me get the dirt in front of the well. Help me to dig it again. Some of us need to go back to an altar and dig that dirt out of our heart and say, God, help me fall in love with the well one more time. Come on, I wish somebody would lift their hands all over this place. I wish somebody would lift your hands and say, God, help me, Lord, to get the dirt out of my well. Help me to unstop the well. I'm telling you how to open a well. The first thing you got to do is you got to get the stuff of this world out of the way. It impedes the flow of water. Come on, lift your hands and touch your chest and say, God, help me to get me out of the way if I'm the one stopping the flow. Sometimes you have to dig to get water. It would be great if every service was an artesian well. I remember my friend, Brother Tommy Baker from Winder, Georgia. I used to preach for him a lot when I was a young evangelist. And he loved to go fishing. He loved to go fishing. And I got in trouble by his wife one time because I talked him into buying a boat that was broken and a trailer. And we pulled it up in his driveway. And she said, Tommy Baker, what have you done? And he said, Brother Vasquez, talk me into it. She said, John Vasquez, you better pack your stuff. She let me stay, but he turned me in. But behind his house, he would go fishing, and he had these minnows that he would not use them all. But behind his house, he had an old artesian well that would bubble up all the time. It just bubbled constantly. And so he would put those minnows in that well to keep them alive for the next fishing trip. The bait shop, well, never mind. I'll go ahead and tell you. The bait shop in his town was called the Happy Hooker. And he didn't want to go in there very much. So if he wouldn't throw away his extra minnows, and I can't say that I blame him. Everybody all right? Everybody okay? I didn't name it that. It wasn't my fault. But that well would bubble up all the time. It was constantly, no matter all the years that I would preach for him, that well behind, you would see that water bubbling up from the ground. Amen. Thank God that there's still water that bubbles up in the Holy Ghost. It would be great if every single service was an artesian well that bubbled up out of the ground. It'd be great if every time I tried to preach, there was just such a mighty anointing that I didn't have to even try, that the Holy Ghost would just fall. But I will tell you, there are times when it's not an artesian well because the enemy has put something to stop up the flow of water. And sometimes you've got to be willing to dig until you get to fresh water one more time. And may I tell somebody in this place, you're waiting for it just to bubble up out of you, and it may never bubble up out of you again unless you get down to business with God and dig some stuff out of your life and say, God, I'm going back to the old well. I'm going to dig that junk out of my heart that the devil put in there. I'm talking about how to dig a well. How to dig a well. The Bible says we have this treasure in an earthen vessel. We're made out of dirt. And sometimes we got to get clean in our heart and our spirit one more time so that we can get fresh water that flows. God, help me. God, help me, Lord Jesus, to not let stuff of this world hinder the flow of the Holy Ghost in my life. God, don't let me get so full of this world that I can't get a flow of the Holy Ghost. Look, when the Holy Ghost moved in here a while ago, if you couldn't feel what was going on, you ought to throw your hands to heaven and say, God, whatever it was that kept me from feeling what was happening in this place, God, help me get it out of my heart. Let me get it out of my spirit. Let me get it out of my soul, because I don't want my earth to stop the flow of... Come on, somebody, you ought to force yourself to praise him right now. You ought to force yourself to respond to the word of God right now. You ought to force yourself to respond to the preaching of God's word. You ought to do whatever it is that's keeping you. You ought to start digging that stuff out and say, God, I need water. I need water. Worldliness is dirt. I don't know if I heard a single amen, so I'm going to say it again. Worldliness is dirt. Carnality is dirt. The things of this world are dirt. Amen. But he's coming back for a church without spot or blemish. God, help me to get the dirt out of my life. Amen. I went in the room this morning. I get here early in the morning, and it was around 7 o'clock or so. I came over this morning, and when I went into the room where we do our difference maker session, there was coffee in the coffee pot, and the grounds were still in. And so what I do when I get here, first thing I do is I go around and make sure the heat is on or the air is on, and make sure that that's all taken care of. And then I make coffee, and then I go to my office and get ready for the day. And so I took that old coffee and those grounds, and I took them down to the kitchen, and I threw the coffee grounds away. And before I did that, on the way, I put I call it a pitcher, but I think it's officially, it was a carafe, a carafe. Something like, it was a pitcher. And I set it there, and I turned the water on, and I just let the water flow into it. And I'd poured the coffee out, but when that water first got in the bottom of that coffee pot, it was the water was dark. It wasn't clean water. So I just let the water flow, and I went on, and I dumped the coffee grounds out. And by the time I came back, the water had flowed into that vessel so much that it had washed away all that old stuff, and the water was clear and pure again. I'm going to tell you what we need is we need to let the Holy Ghost keep flowing into our hearts on a regular basis so that it can keep carrying away the things. That's why the Bible said living water. You know what living water? It's water that keeps on flowing. It just keeps on flowing, and it keeps on flowing. We don't need stagnant, dead, dry church. We need living water to flow into our soul, to carry away the things of this world. Lot's righteous soul was vexed by seeing and hearing. Not by doing and participating, but by seeing and hearing. This world has a way of latching on. That's why we need the Holy Ghost. That's why you ought to fight for your fresh anointing. You ought to fight for your touch from God tonight. You ought to fight for water from the well, because we need fresh water. Look at somebody and tell them worldliness is dirt. That's why when somebody tells something they shouldn't say, what kind of joke is it? Dirty. There's a reason it's called dirty. Let me tell you, if I'd have said some of the things that some of our teenagers talk about, my mom would have washed my mouth out with soap. You don't have to say amen, but it's still true. Amen. I'm telling you, God, help the water. That's why we ought to get our families together, and we ought to pray together that the Holy Ghost be poured out on our lives and on our children and in our soul. Oh, God, help me, Lord Jesus. That's why I take my girls and I walk across this church on Monday nights and I pray out loud, because I'm trying to make sure that the water of heaven flows through my family. Oh God, I don't want the dirt to get in my family's heart. I don't want the dirt to get in my spirit. Come on, you know I'm preaching to you tonight. Somebody's got to sound the alarm. Not everybody can say everything's okay. Sometimes you got to say, we got to get the world out. Come on, you got to get the dirt out of your well. You got to get the dirt out of your well. You got to get the dirt out of your well. I got to hurry on, I guess. So they dug again the wells. Digging's not easy. I remember Brother Nate Whitley. How many remember Brother Whitley? Some of you know him. He's our national youth secretary now. But he interned at our church for 6 months one time, and I had him here, and Brother Wilson had a couple of stints, so I hired Brother Whitley to come, and his job was to do whatever Brother Wilson told him to do, because we didn't want Brother Wilson having a heart attack. And so I told him, I said, your job is to do whatever Brother Wilson says. We don't want Brother Wilson digging. We don't want him cutting. We just want him telling you what to do. And you do it. Because we don't want him to have, he just had another stent. We don't want him to have a heart attack. So me and Sister Wilson had concocted this brilliant plan in our mind that we would save Brother Wilson's life by killing Brother Whitley, making him a sacrifice. It was a good trade for us. A few weeks into it, Brother Whitley said, Brother V, I'm leaving. I said, why? He said, Brother Wilson won't let me do anything for him. He said, Brother V, you brought me here so he wouldn't have to do stuff. But what Brother Wilson's doing is getting twice as much done, because he's still doing what he would do anyway and giving me more stuff to do. He said, you're wasting your money, because he's still going to kill himself. So me and Sister Wilson had a talk with Brother Wilson, but it didn't do any good. So finally one day, Brother Wilson knocked on the door of the apartment where Nate was staying. He knocked on the door. He said, Brother Whitley, you want a job? Yeah, Brother Wilson, that's why I'm here. He said, okay, get a shovel. Okay. He took him out to the cemetery. And he said, we got an urn to bury. We need you to dig the grave. So he goes digging in that hard, rocky clay up on top of that hill. You can't go half an inch without hitting a rock. And he dug all day. He dug for hours, and he was about 3 or 4 inches deep. And he went to Brother Wilson. He said, Brother Wilson, I can't dig this grave. It's too hard. It's the ground's so hard. I can't make it. He said, get a water hose. So he gets a water hose, and he lets the water run to soften the dirt. And he digs about 3 more inches, and he does that, and he does it for like 2 days. You find Brother Whitley, and you tell him, ask him something about Potts Camp, and you know what he's going to say? Brother Wilson tried to kill me, making me dig a grave. And he'll say, I thought he was making me dig my own grave. But there was something about that water that would soften up that hard earth. There was something about that water that no matter how much digging and how much hitting you tried to do, that it needed that water to begin to soften it up so you could get somewhere. And I'm going to tell you that I can dig and I can dig and I can preach and I can preach. I basically preach the same 6 or 7 sermons over and over now for almost 14 years to the same people, trying to get the same result that I've been trying to get 14 years. There's still people that I'm trying to get you to pray through that in 14 years I've never seen you pray through. I've been trying to get you to worship, and I still haven't seen you lift your hands in worship. But you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to keep on pouring water, because at some point that's going to get soft in that old earth. That old dirt is going to be washed away. And God knows that we need fresh water. So God, let the water flow. Let the water flow. Let the water flow. And let it soften my heart, God. I'm going to tell you, sometimes my heart gets hard. Sometimes my heart gets hard. It was just a few days ago, Brother Michael, in frustration. It was earlier this week in frustration. I was by myself. And in frustration, it was just me and God, and I began to tell God exactly what I thought about some things. Stuff that I'd been holding for months and 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 months. Frustration. And I just started pouring it out, and I just started telling God about it and how I thought he ought to handle it. And then when I got done sucking my thumb and being a baby, see what happened? My heart had gotten hard. But then I finally got to the point where I shut my mouth and I quit complaining and I let God talk. And God said, just pray about it. Just pray about it. Just talk to me about it. Just ask me to work on it and I'll fix it. But I'm not going to fix it with your hard heart and your stony heart. So I had to let the water flow. I had to let the Holy Ghost get a hold of me again. You hear what I'm saying? I know I'm the preacher, but I'm telling you, I had to let the Holy Ghost get a hold of my heart one more time. I had to let God wash my heart clean so I could get to a point where you may never have gotten that way. You've probably always been perfect, but I'm going to tell you, I fight myself more than I fight anything else in this world. And sometimes I got to get the dirt out of my heart because I need water to flow in my spirit. And I need the Holy Ghost. And I can't afford to lose out this close to the rapture. I can't afford to lose out this close to the finish line. I can't afford to let the world get in my spirit. I can't afford to let bitterness and malice get a hold of my heart. So God, wash me one more time. So Jacob came to a place where there were flocks gathered around a well. Matter of fact, the Bible said there were three flocks of sheep. Brother Murphy, I've looked at that. You know how preachers do. They'll find something in there and think, I wonder what that means. So my thought was, I wonder how big a flock of sheep is. And so I looked it up. And a flock is anywhere from 25 to 5,000. I thought, well, that's a nice way to narrow it down. So I'm going to guess there weren't 5,000. So let's say that at the minimum there's 25. So that would be three flocks. That'd be, look, here comes the math genius, 75. So let's just say there's at least 75 sheep, maybe up to a few hundred. And they're all gathered at the well. Now, here's a genius question. Why were they gathered at the well? Because they were thirsty. The sheep came because they were thirsty. So Jacob looks and he sees all these sheep by the well. Man, it's hot out here. The sheep probably wanted to tell the shepherds that if you were wearing a fur coat, you'd get the rock off the well. But here they are. They're gathered by the well because they're thirsty. And Jacob looks and he says, it's high day. It's the middle of the day. It's the hottest part of the day. And the sheep are by the well. Why aren't you giving them water? Well, we can't. Why can't you give them water? Because they said that we can't give them water right now. It's not water time. Water time is later. Right now, it's dying of thirst time. Later on, it'll be water time. But right now, it's be hot time. So what we're going to do is we're going to let all these sheep stay by the well and be thirsty because somebody decided arbitrarily that it's not time for water yet. So they said they would roll the stone away from the well's mouth and water the sheep and then put the stone back on top of the well. They decided when you could drink and when you couldn't drink. They decided when there would be water and when there wouldn't be water. They decided. I don't know who they were, but they would get on my nerves if I was thirsty and they said I couldn't get a drink of water. Amen. Who do they think they are to decide when somebody can get a drink from water that God put there in the first place? Who do they think they are to have the authority to decide who gets a drink and who doesn't get a drink and when they can get a drink and when they can't get a drink? May I tell you that the moment somebody steps through the doors of this church, if they want the Holy Ghost, it's Holy Ghost time. It doesn't have to wait till the middle, to the end, to the preaching or anything. Whenever God gets to moving, it's time to move. If it's in the prayer room, if it's in the altar, if it's in the singing, if it's in the preaching. When people are thirsty, it's time to say, God, just have your way. I'm tired of ritual. I'm tired of programs. I'm tired of saying when we're going to do this and when we're going to do that. I'm ready for the Holy Ghost just to be poured out like a mighty river, like a wave, like a waterfall, like a monsoon. God, let the rain of the Holy... Come on, somebody. Come on. I'm telling you, it's time for the Holy Ghost revival. I know it's Christmas time, but I feel like it's revival time. It's time for somebody's life to be set on fire. It's time for somebody's soul to be quenched with the fire, with the water of the Holy Ghost. God, come on, I'm thirsty. God, I'll take the help me to take the rock off the well. So all these shepherds are sitting around and thinking, man, I wish it was water time. Come here, Brother Perfecto. Come. You're a shepherd. Come on. How do you say, oh, pastor? In Spanish, pastor, right? Pastor. El pastor, that's shepherd. Amen. Brother Michael, come on. That might work. There's a lot of pastor up here right now. Amen. We're sitting around. There were three flocks, yours, mine, and his. And we're sitting around thinking, man, I wish that these sheep could get a drink. Maybe if they'd get a drink, we could see them through another season. Maybe if we could just get another drink of water, maybe we can get them through this dry season that we're in. It's been a long time since we had the kind of rain we wanted. But if we could get the water out of this well, it'd sure be good, because we sure need a drink of water from the well. You see that sheep over there? That sheep has been having trouble with its ewe. Amen. And see that one over there? That sheep's lamb has just been attacked by a wolf, and it's sick. And it's not going to heal if it's dehydrated. So we got to find that lamb needs another drink. And you see that old ram over there? That ram is old and aged, and it can't handle the heat like it used to. And if we don't get water soon, that ram's not going to survive this heat wave. So what we got to do, when are they going to let us get a drink of water? When are they going to say it's okay for us to open the well up? When are they going to allow us? Look, I'm tired of the devil dictating to us when we can have revival and when we can't. And I'm tired of the devil telling us when our kids can pray through and when they can't. I'm tired of him making us wait till youth convention and then youth camp and then camp meeting and then revival. I'm saying tonight's a good night to get the rock off the well. But if we're going to get the rock off the well, you got to put your shoulder to it. Because the water's not going to push the rock off. We got to push the rock off. It's time for moms and dads to put their shoulder to the rock and say, as for me and my house, we're going to have revival. We're going to get it together. We're going to serve God. It's time for some dads to say, come on, son, we're coming to prayer meeting. It's time for some husbands to say, come on, we're going to worship God. Let's go to the altar and let's praise God. You got to put your shoulder. I'm talking about how to get water from the well. You got to put your shoulder to the rock. And do I have any rock pushers? Do I have any rock pushers in the house tonight? That's going to say, I don't care what song they're singing. I don't care who's preaching. I don't care what's going on. I've made up my mind. I'm not going to settle for the rock on the well. I'm not going to settle for a dry family. I'm not going to settle for a dry prayer life. I'm not going to settle for a dry youth group. I'm not going to settle for a dry home. I'm not going to settle for a dry family. I will put my shoulder to the rock and I will push until the water comes up. You had to get water from the well. You got to push. You got to push. You got to push. If you want water from the well, you got to push. Do I have any rock pushers in the house that's going to say, I don't care what's happening. I've made up my mind. I'm going to be a revival. I'm going to put my shoulder. I'm going to put my, come on, somebody push right now. Somebody push right now. Push with your prayer. I'm going to push this church through to another level of revival. I'm going to push through an intercessory prayer. I'm going to push through by fasting. I'm going to push through by responding when the Holy Ghost gets to moving. I'm not going to settle for a dry worship service. I'm going to push. I'm not going to settle for a dry preaching. I'm going to push. I'm not going to settle for a dry altar service. I'm going to push because I got to get the rock off the well. Oh, come on, it's time. It's time to talk to heaven a little bit. Sometimes you got to dig, and sometimes you got to push. Look at somebody and tell them, sometimes you got to dig. Sometimes you got to dig the world out of you. Sometimes you got to dig sin out of your life. Sometimes you got to dig worldliness out of your heart. Sometimes you got to dig worldliness out of your soul. Sometimes you got to dig carnality out. Hey, I don't always feel like praying, but I know I got to dig that out so I can have. Sometimes you got to dig, and sometimes you got to push. Hey, hallelujah. Somebody needs to do some digging today, and somebody else needs to do some pushing. But then the Bible says the last way to get water out of the well is with joy. It's how you draw water out of the wells of salvation. That word joy comes from the same root as the word rejoice. Sometimes you can dig all you want to dig, and you can push all you want to push. But sometimes you just get to the point where you've got to rejoice your way to the water. You've got to get your praise back. I said you got to get your praise back. Because praise draws water out of the wells of salvation. You can't sit dead without worship and wonder why you're not getting water. You got to worship with joy. Shall you draw water out of the way? Sometimes you got to praise your way through to victory. When you don't feel like it, you still praise. Come on, you know I'm preaching to you. Some of you got to shake your praise loose tonight. Some of you have let yourself get stagnant in your worship. You've let yourself get cold in your praise. You need to push your way to rejoicing, rejoicing, rejoicing. Because with joy shall you draw water. Somebody that hadn't praised in a while, you ought to throw your hands to heaven and you ought to let a shout up out of your soul. You ought to let a praise up out of your spirit right now. Somebody that hadn't picked their feet up in a while, you ought to start picking those feet up in praise and rejoice. And I promise you that with joy shall you draw water out of the wells of salvation. How do you open a well? Sometimes you dig for it. Sometimes you push for it. And sometimes you praise for it. That's how you open a well. I wish everybody in this place would humor me for just a moment and just begin to worship God and just begin to praise God and just begin to have yourself a Holy Ghost hallelujah time and begin to worship the Lord and begin to draw water out of the wells of salvation. Oh God, oh God, we got to open the well. You might have to dig, you might have to push, and you might have to praise. But whatever it takes, God, pour the water out on this church. God, let a well spring up in Bethlehem. God, let a well spring up in Bethlehem. God, let a well of revival. Come on, somebody. Somebody help me praise God for the next revival that's coming. Somebody help me shout for the next one that gets the Holy Ghost. Somebody help me shout for revival in our youth group and revival in our elders and revival in our middle-aged folks. God, I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to draw water from the wells. I may have to dig, I may have to push, and I may have to rejoice. But anyway, I'm getting the water. I'm getting the water. Somebody ought to take somebody by the hand and just shout a little bit. Hey, hallelujah, hallelujah, I refuse to go home dry. I refuse to go home dry. I refuse to go home thirsty. I've come with my mind made up. If I gotta dig, I gotta dig. If I gotta push, I gotta push. And if I gotta shout, I gotta shout. But I made up my mind. I'm not going home dry anymore. Spring up, oh well. Spring up. Come on, you ought to draw the water up out of your soul right now. Spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. Hey, hallelujah. 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 Hey, I'm going on in revival. I'm going forward. I'm not looking back. I'm not going back. I'm going forward in revival. I may have to dig a little bit. I may have to push, and I may have to praise, but I refuse to be dry. The unclean spirit goes through dry places. Demonic spirits like dry places. The devil likes dry prayer lives and dry worship and dry church and dry preaching. The devil likes dry places. He walks through dry places seeking recreation. That's why you can't let yourself dry out, because you become a playground for the devil. You become a place that the devil likes to play when you let yourself dry out. You ought to do anything you can right now to let the Holy Ghost touch you. Spring up, oh well, within my soul. Spring up, oh well, within my soul. God, help me, Lord Jesus. Help me, God, to dig the carnality out of my life. Help me, God, to push the rocks out of my way. And help me, God, to rejoice and draw water from the wells of salvation. That's how you open a well. Glory to God. I feel the Holy Ghost up here. I feel some stuff starting to break in the spirit. I feel some stuff starting to shake loose in somebody right now. Hey, come on, you ought to push a little bit more. You ought to dig a little bit more. You ought to praise Him a little bit more. Your breakthrough's not far away from you, sir. Your breakthrough's not far away from you, ma'am. Your revival's closer than you think it is. Your breakthrough's closer than you think it is. Spring up, oh well, spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well, spring up, oh well, spring up. Spring up, oh well, spring up. God, let the water of the Holy Ghost fall upon this congregation. God, these are your people. Every one of them are your people, God. I pray that the well of the Holy Ghost would spring up in their life. I pray, God, that you would bless them coming and going. I pray that you bless their homes, bless their marriages, bless their families, bless their children, bless their health, bless their mind, body, and soul. I pray you bless them with all manner of spiritual blessings. Let the hand of the Lord be upon your people. Make the crooked places straight. Bring down the obstacles in their lives, oh God. Let there be a wave of revival that doesn't just happen in church. But come on, somebody help me pray. We're taking some spiritual territory. God, let a wave of revival flow through your people. Let a fresh desire spring up in our heart. Oh God, let a fresh move of the Holy Ghost dig deep in our soul. Oh, in the name of the Lord, help us, oh God. Help us, oh God. Help us to be well diggers. Help us, God, to be rock pushers. And help us to rejoice for the water from the wells of salvation. Oh, Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Bring up a well.